Good Chodesh. I'd like to publicly thank the Queens Jewish Community Council, Chazaq, and Chickens for Shabbos for making tonight's event a reality. At this time, I'd like to call upon the Marda Aser of Welcher to start with a capital Tehillim and Divrei Psicha.
Mizvah Kuf Lamed. Shira malo is mi mama king rosi khaduna Adina is mo be koili tieno sne kho kashvo is li ko yul ta khaduna Adina is mo yo aduna mi yamai Yimchas licha liman divorei. Kivisi Adonai kibeso nafshi v'lidvaro yecholte. Nafshi l'Adonai mishamerim labayiker, shamerim labayiker. Yachel Yisrael al Adonai, Yigim Adonai HaChesed, Barbeim Ofedo. O Yiftes Yisrael, Mikai Lavenesa. Pinocho Meis Yisrael, Anasun Matzor, Vashiv Yom, Adim Mayom, Uvain, Mayab, Ashol, Mokom, Mirafim, Aleim, Yotzim, Mitzor, Luach, Mavid, Leir, Mishiv, Lugula, Ashto, Bagol, Vazhan, Gariv, Aymar, Amen. We gather this Mitzvah Shabbos. I want to welcome all those that have come. And little did we know weeks ago when this gathering was scheduled how significant and poignant a time it would be. None of us could have imagined the horrific events which took place this past week in Yerushalayim. And therefore it's important that we come together at this hour. I spoke at length this morning about it, and I don't intend really to go over what I said this morning. But suffice it to say, the Gemara says at the end of Makkos, as the Dervish went on, the Nevi'im attempted to isolate those most fundamental of the halachas of the Torah. Musical accompaniment, thank you. The most fundamental halachos of the Torah. And finally, Chavak came, Bo Chavakuk, Amidon al Achas. They were on the list, and Chav Dalar Amar Aleph and Marcus. Chavak came and said that there's one Yesod that we have to focus on, and if we focus on that, we can succeed with all our Avedas Hashem. And what is that Yesod with Tzaddik, B'Emunah, So Yichye, Amuna. Amuna is the Yesod. Amuna is where we most need chizuk after the events which took place in Eretz Yisrael. It's a direct challenge in Amuna, and we have to strengthen ourselves thereby in Amuna. Yidin, in the midst of tefillah, with talis and tefillah, standing in Shmon Esra before the Rabbeinu Shalala, and cut down in such horrific fashion. The only parallel that we have to be able just a little bit to put the mind, a frame of reference, is Lo Aleinu, the incidents of 70 years ago of the Holocaust. And we thought that Baruch Hashem, that Chevle Mashiach is behind us. We're not going to witness it again. And Lo Aleinu, we witnessed such horror this past week. As we come together, it's a propitious moment to strengthen ourselves in Amunah and our service of the Rabbeinu Shel Olam, which is ultimately the only way that we can respond. We're fortunate this evening. I want to welcome Rav Finkelman to our Beis HaKnesses. I believe the first time that we've had this. One other time? He's right before. We've had the schus to have him, and I'm glad that we have the schus again tonight. And Shmoy Heilech Lefonov, he's a person that's Mura Me'om, and he's a person who's extremely dedicated to the Tzibur. His interaction with the Bochrum and Yeshiva, his interaction with couples. He's a Yofa Derish, a Yofa Mekayim. And it's certainly a very, very special privilege that we can have him address us from this bima this evening. And we're honored, in fact, that all of these organizations have come together to bring us an evening of chizuk before the Rabbeinu Shel Olam. I just want to apologize to the Olam, as I did privately to Rav Finkelman. I personally have a speaking obligation in Yeshiva Chabad Chaim in the next few minutes, so I'm going to have to leave before the drosha. And I can only offer you the lament of the famed Maggid of Shalom Shvadron Zeichet Tzadik Livrocha, whom I did know. And I recall many, many years ago, he was speaking in Rav Teitelbaum Shul, Zeichet Tzadik Livrocha, the father of the present Rav, of Yankov Teitelbaum Zatzal. And he stopped to muse for a moment. And he said, oh, Lord Gewurzen, it would be beautiful, he said, here I could sit in the audience and hear a darshan explain the medrash and listen to the words of chizuk. So I certainly, as one that normally has the responsibility to be on the bima, I would certainly wish to have the opportunity to listen to the words of Chizuk from Rav Finkelman. But I have another public responsibility, so again, my apologies to the Tzibur and to Rav Finkelman, and for Rav Finkelman, please come through.
Rabbi Welcher, that I'm able to stand up here and address such a very chashuv olam. I want to thank the Belisha who invited me on behalf of all the organizations that are running this. And I also, when I accepted the privilege to speak here, I also had no idea the events that would precede this. But I did prepare accordingly, since we can't ignore. And I think that's why HaKadosh Baruch Hu brought such a tremendously difficult and painful situation to us, that we shouldn't be able to ignore it. Because somehow, as we get used to different incidents going on between the Arabs and Klal Yisrael, so we don't realize that they're all messages from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. That if we want it to stop, there are things that we can do, that we should do. And personally, when I heard this unbelievable and shocking situation the morning that it happened, I thought to myself right away, why did HaKadosh Baruch Hu do it in this way, during a Shemayin Esrei, in a Beis HaKnesses, in a Beis HaMedrash? It's both a place of learning and davening, and such B'nai Torah themselves, and such a horrific way to die, Rahman al-Islam. So I thought perhaps it had to do, and I spoke to the Bachram about it, it had to do with the fact that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is demanding from us, is demanding of us to pay more attention to our relationship with Him when we learn Torah, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu talks to us through Torah. Torah is an experience of Hashem talking to us. In Tanya Debi Eliyahu, it's brought down that when we learn Torah, the neshama of the person who we are learning from, if it's Rashi, if it's Moshe Rabbeinu, the Chumash itself that he taught us, or Abaye and Rav and the Gemara, the neshamas come and they sit opposite us and they talk to us, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu sits opposite us and talks to us. Torah is Hashem talking to a person. And Tefillah, we are talking to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And sadly to say that sometimes we don't behave that way. I've had the experience, and I'm not blaming people. I know that nebuch, we become creatures of habit. But I was once sitting in the shul, it wasn't our base medrash, I had to daven someplace else one morning, and it was Birchas Kriya Shema. It was actually Ahava Rabba before Shema Yisrael. And the person sitting next to me, all of a sudden his cell phone came alive. It's one of these big, you know, screen phones, either an iPhone or whatever they call them, smartphones, lighter, they're not too smart. They're satan, they're very smart. Ooh, for the satan, it's very brilliant. But I don't know exactly how smart it is for us. But in any case, with the tzitzis between the fingers, ready for Kriya Shema, looking at what was the message. You know, so I thought perhaps what HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants. It seems though, and I spoke to the Bachram about this, but I heard that in yesterday's Hamodiyah there was an open letter from the widows of all four almanas signed it together during the Shiva. They wrote a letter to Klal Yisrael begging for better achdus, better joining together and caring about each other. And they felt that that was a chesaron, and that their husbands were karbonos for our not being together. And achdus, we always, when we hear that word, if we read such a letter, we think it means we should appreciate Yidden from all walks of life. That's true. But achdus really begins at home. That there should be achdus between husband and wife, and achdus between parent and child. And then it can spread to all of Klal Yisrael. But achdus means everything. So I want to speak about a Yesod, a fundamental midah. Rabbi Welcher, Zalzayin Gesundheit, he spoke this morning about emunah, belief in Hashem, which of course is the fundamental foundation of everything in Klal Yisrael. We can't have trust in Hashem until we believe in Hashem. And we understand that everything has a master plan. You know, I was thinking of the horrific way that these Kedoshim died. So it brought to mind, there's a sefer called L'Shichnei Siddush, a beautiful two-volume sefer from Eretz Yisrael. And it's a collection of halacha and agodo, halacha and stories. And there's stories that are documented. There's one story there written over in modern-day Hebrew by Yom Tov Erlich, Zichrono Livracha, a war survivor who ultimately ended up in America. Many of us enjoy a lot of his songs through, that he wrote. He left hundreds of songs in Yiddish that were translated to Lashon HaKodesh for the public. But he was a very, very deep and caring Jew, and he wrote over a particular story that the prize Talmud of the Arizal, Rav Chaim Vital, had written when they were living in Tzfas, about a certain woman, Nebuch, whose husband passed away when she had 10 children. Only one child was married. She was left with 9 Yesomim and Yesomos in the house. She was very broken. And it was in the whole story how one Friday night she had a cholam, a dream that she saw her husband, you know, in the dream, and she saw where he was in Gan Eden. And he answered certain questions for her. One of the questions that she asked him, and finally, after answering a few questions, he said to her, "You're not supposed to know the answers. You're supposed to have emunah and believe in Hashem. You're not supposed to know." Well, he answered a number of questions and he stopped. He stopped her from asking anymore. But one of the questions she asked was, they had an 11th child at one time, a little 3-year-old, who, Rahmanul Islam, was killed by a drunkard. And she said, why did he have to die? A 3-year-old, what did he do wrong? A pure child, couldn't ever do a sin. So he said, I'll take you and show you where he is in Gan Eden and who he was last time he was here on the earth, and that all he had to do was live the 3 years and then he was able to get to his Gan Eden. So she said, then why was he killed brutally? If all he had to do was live 3 years, okay, so he should die peacefully and go back to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and go back to his Gan Eden. So he answered her that in our town there was something very wrong, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu had a choice. You know, the Ebishter makes his decisions out of love for us, to either bring a tzara on a big group of people, or since their child had to be nifter anyhow, their 3-year-old, that it would be done in a way that would affect everybody and pain everybody. It would make everybody think about doing tshuva instead of hurting so many different people. And he said that, and that's where he answered that question. After that, he told her, you know, no more questions. He says, your job on Olam Hazeh is to work on your emunah. Now, part of Emuna is Emes, and I'd like to go through the Parshiyos and the Rosh Chodesh Kislev and the Yom Tov of Chanukah a little bit in the time that we have to give ourselves a tool to be able to accept what HaKadosh Baruch Hu does, but try to prevent it by really improving ourselves. So I'd like to look at different nisyonis, different tests that our Avos had in the parashas that we've read, in the upcoming parashas of the month of Kislev, and to find the common denominator that gave the koyach to our Avos and Imohis to be able to withstand and pass these tests with flying colors. The first one I want to touch on is Lech Lecha Me'artzecha. Avram Avinu and Sarah Imenu were comfortable where they were, even though they were living among Rishoyim. But Lamaisa, they were raised there. It was their family. HaKadosh Baruch Hu was not revealing to them where they were going. HaKadosh Baruch Hu simply said, El Ha'oratz Asher Ar-Eko, they should pick themselves up, leave everything they've known, the family they've known. By then, you know, Avram's father had done tshuva. It wasn't that his father was the same Avodah Zarah salesman that he had been before. And they did it, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu said so. They left Haran, and they went to and ended up going to Eretz Yisrael, but they had no idea where they were going. What was the strength? What's the Yesod, the foundation that they had to be able to do this and pass their tests? The Akedah, the 10th test, where it was against everything Avram Avinu stood for. The Zohar HaKadosh translates, Vayar es hamokoim meirochoik. Simply translated, it means that Avraham Avinu saw the place from a distance. He saw Har HaMeiriah. He was able to see the Shekhinah. So he realized that's where he was supposed to go. That's Poshet Pshat. But we know that Mokim also means Hashem. We give a bracha to an Avel, and we wish this to all those Avelim, Nebuchadnezzar Eretz Yisrael, that HaMokim Yenachem Eshem. HaKadosh Baruch Hu should can console these people. Who could console such a person? No one. Only HaKadosh Baruch Hu. We call HaKadosh Baruch Hu HaMokoim. Rav Chaim Volozhiner in his Sefer Nefesh HaChaim explains, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu is the place. Everything is within Hashem. Hashem is everything in the world. So we're all within HaKadosh Baruch Hu, so to speak. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu is called Mokoim. Vayaras HaMokoim Meirochek. He saw Hashem so far away from him. Here he was, a person that planted an eshel. He made a hotel. He made his own Arachim seminars. Every Shabbos, he invited people and intellectually spoke to them and brought them close to Hashem. That was his way. He found Hashem intellectually. We look at the Midrashim, we see. It wasn't an emotional decision on his part. That all of a sudden he felt a love for Hashem. It was intellectual. He saw a Bira Delekes, two Pshatin. Either Poshe Pshat, Bira Delekes, he saw a palace ablaze with lights. Lights were on, lights were going on, lights were going off, the sun, the moon, the constellations. And he said to himself, in my house, by my parents, excuse me, by my parents, you can go right through the front. Somebody has to turn on the candles and put out the candles in order for there to be light, or light should go out. This world is a world full of chesed. Who is running this world? It can't be an accident. There has to be a Bal HaBira, an intellectual study. Another pshat, Bira Delekes, he saw the world ablaze with sin. And he said, it can't be. This world is not hefker. Someone has taken care of this world, and he's letting so much sin go on in the world. Where is the creator of the world? How long will he let this go on? And HaKadosh Baruch Hu revealed himself. He said, you're looking for the Bal HaBira? Anihu Bal HaBira. I'm the master of this palace. And Lech Lecha Me'artzecha. But now all of a sudden he was asked. So he went and he told everyone, every Shabbos. He fed them. He fed them well. That's one of the ways to bring people close to Hashem. I was by a seminar that Rabbi Freifeld, Zichron Levracha, the founder of Shur Yoshuv, the Rosh Yeshiva, he gave a Kirov seminar. So he was telling us about being makar of people to Shabbos, which everybody in this community was involved in a couple of weeks ago, the project, Shabbos project. So he said, don't give them speeches about Shabbos. That's not what's going to do it. He says, serve them good food and a lot of it, and they'll come back again. And they'll experience the Shabbos at your table without the drusha, the experience. They'll feel it. and they're going to want to keep Shabbos. We see it from Avraham Avinu. He was running after cattle. He wanted to give them a delicacy, three tongues with mustard, it says in Rashi, whatever delicacy that was, you know, that people enjoyed in those days. Why did he do that? To be makarev people. And he told them, Hashem is kulei chesed. All he wants is kindness, and he does kindness. He doesn't want human sacrifice. And all of a sudden, he understood Hashem was asking him to sacrifice not only a human, but his own son. And after Hashem promised him that the future of Klal Yisrael would be through his son Yitzchak, Yitzchak wasn't even married, and Hashem asked him, as far as he understood, to sacrifice Yitzchak. Vayaras hamokam, he saw Hashem, meirachayk, from a distance. He didn't understand anymore how Hashem was close to him. But he still went, and Yitzchak participated. The Akedas Yitzchak, it's not called Akedas Avraham, that Avraham bound his son. It's really called Akedas Yitzchak, because Yitzchak asked to be bound, it says in the Medrash. He said to his father, I'm frightened that when you pick up the knife, my instinctive desire to live will cause me to move my arm to protect myself. And I won't allow you to do what you have to do. And I might, Hashem, even hit you by accident. So tie me very tightly, so that I shouldn't ruin your avodah that you want to do. So it's like, hey, that's Yitzchak. Yitzchak asked for it. What gave them the strength? Rivka. Basically, if you look at the psukim and try to figure it out, we want to understand that she's older than three. It's hard to imagine a three-year-old girl, you know, being so mature to do all the things that she did. But it's hard to understand differently, really, from the psukim. Because we see in this week's parasha that we laying today that they first davened for this powerful tefillah for children 20 years later. And Rashi explains that when she got married at three, so she was too young until she was 13 to expect to have a child. Then they waited 10 years after that for this vi'atira. But yet there was a powerful, they davened all the years, but it was a more powerful tefillah after the 10 years. So at the age of three, her family didn't want her to leave because her father had just passed away. He tried to kill Eliezer, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu made him die instead that night. So the family was just mourning for the father who just passed away, and they didn't want her to leave. And the Medrash says, so Eliezer said, let's ask her if she wants to go. We'll ask her if she wants to go. So the Medrash says, when they asked her, said, Haselchi, do you want to go with this man? It says they were wagging their finger at her, like warning her, don't say yes. They asked her in a rhetorical type of way that she shouldn't say yes, like you're going to leave us now, middle of Shiva, you're going to leave and go with this man? Haselchi? Haselchi? Do you think you're going to go with him? And she said, Eilech, I want to go with him. And she wanted to go. Then she ended up going at that age. And then we see in the parasha we read this morning, the unbelievable strength that she had. Number one, that she didn't want her husband to know what was going on with Esav. Let's just analyze it together. We get tremendous lessons for ourselves in life from this. That Rabbi Moshe Wolfson has in his Sefer Emunah Sitecho. If we analyze the stories in the end of today's parsha, that Yitzchak, uncharacteristic of a tzaddik, he says to Esav, Aseli matanim kasher ahavti. Make me tasty foods that I love. We don't hear a tzaddik saying he loves food. You know, a tzaddik says he loves Hashem, he loves Klal Yisrael, he loves mitzvahs, loves to daven. You're not going to hear a tzaddik saying he loves sushi, he loves... Someone told me recently that they saw in the biography of Rav Moshe, and the same thing in writing about Rabbi Victor Miller, Zichronom Levracha, that neither of them ever went over to the fridge to take a snack. Whatever they were served, that's what they ate. Because that's the way of tzaddikim. They're not into food. They're just not into it. That Yitzchak should say, Asher Ahavti, that I love. In the beginning of the parasha tells us that Yitzchak loved Esav, ki tzayid befiv, one of the pshatim in Rashi, that Esav captured his father by feeding him food, by preparing food that Yitzchak liked. He was mechabed him. So Yitzchak loved him. All of a sudden, at the end of the parasha, when Esav brings in what he hunted and brought and prepared, Yitzchak trembled. And Rashi says he felt Gehenna come in. What happened? so many times, in years already, he's being fed by Esav and he loves the food, and for whatever reason he says he loves it. All of a sudden he feels Gehenna, something happened here. Something changed. Yaakov is worried. He's so frightened to do this, to trick his father. He says, Ula yimusheni ovi, my father might touch me, though yisti behenav kimisateya. I'll be like making fun of him, like I'm making a joke out of my father. It's going to upset him. And if it upset a parent, it's an oror, it's a curse in the Torah. The ovi has kept the Torah. It says, oror makla ovi v'imai. Cursed is the person that cheapens his parents. If he makes his parents uncomfortable, he embarrasses them, he puts them down. It's a curse in the Torah. Ora makal ava v'imai. Cursed is that person. So he's afraid. I'm going to be in his eyes like somebody who's making fun of him. That's misateya. Ve'hevesi olai klola. I will bring a curse upon myself because the Torah says so. Not that Hashem Yitzchak would curse his child. That would never happen. Not that a parent would ever curse their child. Chas v'shom. But naturally I'll be cursed because the Torah says so. Torah says orur on a person that cheapens his parents' kavod. So Rivka says, we must do this for Klal Yisrael, for the future of the world. You know what your father wants to do? I did a really good trick. My Rebbe puts it in his sefer. What did Rivka do? She saw her husband was learning indoors all the time. He didn't go out. He couldn't see. Yitzchak was blind. He didn't go out. So he didn't hear what they were speaking in the street about his son. She went shopping. She had things to do. People, Nebuch, she heard them talking about Esav. Here he murdered, there he was mezaneh with someone. We see in Rashi, if he was exhausted, what did he do when he sold his bechira that day? It says he did five major aveiros that day. So Rivka said, why should Yitzchak know about this? Why should he know about these things that his son, why should have aggravation unnecessarily? But when she heard that Yitzchak wants to give Esav the bracha, it's because Yitzchak thinks that Esav was a tzaddik nistar, and he would be the zvulun who would support Yaakov and Kailel. She said to Yaakov, no, even if you get cursed, I'll take the curse. I'll take it upon myself. I will accept the curse that's supposed to be upon you from the Torah for cheapening your father if he catches you. If he catches you, I'll take it. If he feels cheapened by you, and therefore there's a curse from the Torah on you, I'll take that curse. Because it's more important than the Esav shouldn't get the brachas. If he gets that money, the brachas of Gashmias, to support Yaakov with, he won't support you with it. He'll make another casino, another movie theater, another New York Post. He'll make another rap artist he'll support. Who knows what he'll do with that money? Another plasma screen that somebody could put in their house and bring the street into the house. Who knows what he's going to do with that? We can't let Esav have that. That's worth it to me. I'll take the curse. She says, I'll take it. Where'd she get the strength? What is that strength to accept it? And let's understand the strength that she had in fooling him, not to hurt him. So Rebbe explains, you know how Yitzchak was fooled by Esav's meals all this time? Because Rivka knew that we are affected, we're very, very fine-tuned spiritual neshamais, Klal Yisrael. The B'nai Shem, the B'nois Shem. Very fine-tuned. Everything affects us, everything we do. So the author of a book, the author of a song, and the author of food, that all comes through. When we listen to a song, I told our Shiurim last week, I mentioned the story that my Rebbe Rav Wolfson told me from his Bacharish days, when he was a Bachar, he enjoyed going to the Moshitz Rebbe, Zichron Levracha, Abshol Yedidya. He created symphonies in music. He was very, he created beautiful, beautiful songs, Moshitz Negunim. So Rebbe liked to go for Shabbos. He was in Crown Heights then, the Moshitz Rebbe, on Carroll Street. So one Shabbos, he went with another Bacher from Torah Vadas. They went together for Shabbos to the Moshitz Rebbe. And this Bacher who went with Rabbi Wolfson had a beautiful voice. And they honored him to daven Kabbalah Shabbos. And he listened to Goyish music on the radio. It wasn't like today's music. Anybody who's my age knows that this is totally new. Today's, what they do, Nebuch, the kind of music, the words, what's allowed today is unbelievable, Nebuch. In our generation, but he listened to Goyish music. So he had a romantic song that he listened to on the radio. He thought it was a beautiful tune. He sang that song for the first part of the Chodoidi. And we sing a slow nigun, the first part. And then he sang a regular Yiddish tune for Loisei Vaishi for the second part of the Chodoidi. After davening, they all went out online to say good Shabbos to the Rebbe. So Rav Wolfson says he was next to his chavir, the Baal Tefillah. Everyone's saying, beautiful, what a tefillah, beautiful. The Rebbe said to him, very beautiful. Where'd you get that nigun you sang for the first part of the Chodoyti? So he was too embarrassed to say the truth, so he lied. He said it was an old European nigun, to which the Mojitzer Rebbe responded, it smacks of immorality. Never sing it again, never. That was a romantic song, it was a love song, but the author didn't have holiness in mind, even though it was a slow, lilting melody. But he had immorality in mind, his romance. Rav Sternbuch, Zotayin Gesund, in his Sefer on Taras HaMishpocha, one of his phrases at the beginning in introducing the beauty of our married life, of Klal Yisrael, of Taras HaMishpocha. So he writes there, Mashahem Kairin Ahava, what the world calls love, Anu Kairin Kores, we call Chiyav Kores. Our love is a whole different level. That's why the Israel is a surah achrei neichem. You know, I look at immodest things as a halachi. You look in the Sefer Achinuch for men and women. Women also can't have these ideas of goyish romance because it's just so the antithesis of our holy life. It's a whole different life. So the author of something puts their koyach into the music, into their book, into their food. So Rivka knew if her son Esav brings the food he got and his hunting to Yitzchak, he's going to feel Esav's real personality. It's in the food. So she would intercept him on the way in. Esav, look at this, you're sweating, you went hunting. Go wash up a little bit, change your clothing, I'll prepare the food. And she threw it into the river. She had her own, as we see, she told Yaakov, go get, bring me a sheep. She had her own stock of animals. She prepared meat that she kashered, that she knew was the way she knew her husband liked it. So Yitzchak was confused. Esav comes in. Now he knew Esav wasn't the base medrash bacher, but when he eats the food, he feels like davening. He feels like learning. There's a Tana, Belezer HaKalir. The meaning Kalir means cookie. So the Rosh says, why was he called? Everyone has a name. The names mean something. He was a blacksmith. Why would you call one of the Tana a cookie? Because his mother baked cookies, and she would give it to him if he learned. That's how she got him to learn. So it remained his name. You know, so Yitzchak took this food, and he said he felt like davening, he felt like learning, he felt like doing a chesed. He said to himself, this fellow is a tzaddik nistar. He seems to be an ama oretz. He asked me questions that make no sense in halacha. Rashi brings them down, the questions that Yitzchak would ask. But when he brings me food, I feel like, I love the food because I feel like davening more. I feel like learning more. It's because Rivka authored that food. She cooked it. So this time, it says in the Medrash, HaKadosh Baruch Hu didn't let Esav catch an animal too quickly to give Yaakov a chance to get the brachos. Not only that, says my Rebbe, Esav came running in late. He wanted to bring his father dinner. His father asked, it was Pesach night. It was Pesach night. We know from the Zmiris and the Haggadah that the Brichas Yitzchak took place Pesach night. So he comes running in. Ma, you got to help me. I'm sorry, Esav kid, tonight I can't. I'm so busy, you know. I'm making matzahs. We see that Avram made matzahs. They kept the Torah. They understood what HaKadosh Baruch Hu wanted. The Abbas and the Mohis, they kept the Torah. I can't make you this dinner tonight, but you always do it. And tonight of all nights, I couldn't find something. I just found it. I'm sorry, tonight you have to prepare it yourself. Because she felt at this point her husband must know the truth. He wants to give Esav the Gashmias Tikkur Brachas. He thinks Esav's going to use it for his brother. She knew the truth. So she didn't prepare it. That's why this time when Yitzchak came in, when Esav came in to his father Yitzchak, he trembled. And if you look at the pasuk, you know, he thought he gave Esav the brachas. He thought he gave Esav the brachas. He felt the arm. He said, you sound like Yaakov. You're speaking so respectfully. You said, please get up. Esav never told me please. You see, when Esav comes in, he says, Yaakov, get up, my father. But when Yaakov said, no, please get up. He says, you sound like Yaakov, you feel like Esav, and he gave the brachos thinking it was Esav. all of a sudden, the whole truth opens up to him. And he says, Mi eifa yu hatzot zayid. Who was that person that captured something, brought it to me, and I ate from everything he brought me before you came? Gam baruch yeh. He should keep the brachos. I don't know who it was, but that's what I meant when I said I love the food. What he brought me, it gave me that surge of ruchnius. What you're bringing me, I feel Gehenna. So whoever that was, he should keep the brachos. Now, of course, we know it was Yaakov, and he knew very soon afterwards that it was Yaakov. What gave Rivka this tremendous amount of strength to be able to keep this painful secret for years, suffering alone, knowing who her son was, and her husband shouldn't have to suffer along and know about it till he had to know when he wanted to give away precious brachos. So she had to let him know. What gave her the strength and her son Yaakov? He heard his mother's reasoning. He knew she was right, but it was frightening to him. It was very scary to him to still take a chance getting cursed. His father should realize what he did, and his father should have tinus and feel cheapened that his son fooled him. Now, the truth is, as bad as we think Esav was, we learn a tremendous lesson from Esav. Because once he heard the statement from his father, he said, "Hachikara shmo Yaakov? Is it any accident that you called him Yaakov?" Yaakov means a heel. He was holding onto the heel of Esav. But Yaakov also means to trick. V'yakveni zeh pa'amoyim. We call, in English, we call a person a heel, right? When he's a tricker and he's dishonest, he's a heel. He does some things that he's not supposed to do. He fooled me twice. Ooh, he fooled me twice. He explained to his father. He bought the bechayra from me, and now he took my brachos. So first of all, Yitzchak heard for the first time that Esav sold the bechayra. Could you imagine such a revelation to a father so many years later? He sold his bechayra. But the fact is, if you look in Pirkei Rabbi Eliezer, when Esav sold the bechayra, we make a suda for a pidyon haben, to show how much we appreciate that we believe in Hashem, that every child is a gift from Hashem, and we have to redeem the firstborn. But one of the reasons we do it, Pirkei Rabbi Eliezer brings down, because Esav made a big party for all his friends when he sold the Bechira. He said, ha ha, he thinks he got something. He got something you can't even see for the future. He says, you serve Hashem, you base Hamikdash. I got Olam Hazeh. You know, he gave me things that they made a deal that Yaakov told him you could have Olam Hazeh, this world, and I'll have Olam Habo. That's why in Parshas Vayishlach, when they meet, so Esav has a taina on Yaakov. He says, Mi Eilalach, what are you doing with wives and children? That's Olam Hazeh. To Esav, what's a wife? Somebody to show off with. She has to look beautiful. We don't want other men to look at our wives. No, that's not by Esav. Esav, children, they're going to take over the business, they're going to support me when I get old. He thought women and children are Olam Hazeh, and he had a taina to Yaakov. Mi Eilalach, what are you doing with women and children? He had four wives, he had at least 25 children at that point in time. So Yaakov said to him, Habonim asher chanan elikim esavdecho. My wives and children are not your wives and children. You sold me Olam Habo. Olam Habo is like a second story of a building. Olam Hazeh is down here, Olam Habo is up there. There's halacha in Baba Basra. If you sell somebody a second story flat in a building with a few floors, you have to give them a staircase to get to that flat, to get to that apartment. So my women and children, they're my way to get closer to Hashem. When we get married, we marry somebody who's going to build us, we're going to grow together closer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And we hope through our children we're going to grow closer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. That's what it's all about. That's what he answered Esav. Don't worry, you got yours. But Esav made a party. So it looked like Esav thought he got the better deal. But all of a sudden, the truth came out that Esav knew how precious his father's brachos were. He cried, don't you have any bracha left for me? And Yaakov tricked me twice. He took my whole future away. At this point in time, when he was touched by truth, he realized his party was nothing. He made a big mistake selling the Bechaira. He said it, Ve'akveni, he fooled me. What kind of statement is that? I didn't see it in any sefer, but I mamash believe that's pshat. that Esav at this time of truth realized he made a tovus, even with the Bechayra, he made a tovus. He made a mistake in the end. Let's go a little bit further. This week's parasha, Vayetze. Rachel gives away her simonim to Leah, and in such a big way. I heard from Rav Ezrachi in Eretz Yisrael, as well as Ein Gesund, the son of Lover, from Chaim Shmulevitz. In this week's parasha, we find that so Rachel gives the simonim away, and Leah gets married, and Rachel generously doesn't want to embarrass her sister. But Yaakov really wanted to marry Rachel. So he doesn't even wait for Shana Rishonah to be over. After Sheva Brachas, the next there's a wedding, the eighth day. After he marries Leah, he marries Rachel. 8 days later. 6.5 years later, Leah already has 4 children. She already said Hoidoah on Yehuda. And Reuven, sweet little Reuven, probably close to 7 years old, he's picking flowers for his mommy. He comes home with Dudoim. So the Medrash tells us Dudoim were a leaf, an herb, shaped like a human being. And the skula is, you soak it in, you make a tea from it, it's a skula to have children. Rachel has no children yet. She sees this. She says to her sister, could I have some of those Dudoim that Reuven brought you? She needs them. Leah doesn't need them. Leah Brachshem has 4 children. And they were all Nevi'os, these Imahis. They knew there are 12 Shvatim. There are 4 women married to Yaakov, right? So each one would have 3 children. Leah already has 4. And Leah says to her in pain, Hama'at kachtech esishi. Is it little that you took my husband? Now you want my Dudoim? We see that Leah, when she went, she felt bad that she saw Yaakov really cared more for Rachel. When she had Levi, he was the 3rd child. Hapam yilova ishi. My husband's going to have to spend more time with me because I only have 2 hands and I have 3 children. He's going to have to, spend, hapam yilova ishi. You see how much she wanted that attention from Yaakov. So you'd think Rachel would look at her and say, what? I took your husband. I gave you my husband. You know you're the older sister and you were crying for years you shouldn't marry Esav. And our father tricked me by dressing you up and I gave you the simonim. She didn't say a word. But the question is, how could Leah say it? Leah forgot in 7 years what Rachel did for her? It's impossible that that's pshat. So Rav Ezrachi said over when I was in Eretz Yisrael for the yeshiva years ago, he said that Rachel was the premier balas chesed, quintessential balas chesed. We can't picture her chesed. She didn't want Leah. She wasn't giving her the simonim. I'm going to let her think that she wasn't first choice. He's marrying her anyhow. Let her feel that she's the first choice. Let her feel mama, she wants her if he's marrying her. So she didn't just say, here are my simonim. I don't want you to be embarrassed. She said, Yaakov changed his mind. He felt Yashrus is Yashrus. You're older, I'm younger, he's marrying you. He's marrying you first. And then we'll see what he'll do after that. But he's so afraid of our father, the tricker. He's so afraid that he gave trick simonim. He gave simonim about me, to you. So that way he'll know it's you. Because he just doesn't trust our father, because there's simonim were about Rachel. So he gave tricks him on him because he wants to marry you. He made her feel that she was desirable. So therefore, when she saw Rachel let herself get married to Yaakov 8 days later, it bothered her. She didn't say anything right away, but it bothered like, you just told me I was the chosen one. You just told me that he decided to marry me first. Give me your Shana Rishonah. Give me at least a year with him and then marry. Then why don't you say no to him? Why did you say yes after 8 days? You're marrying him. Another chuppah. She didn't say a word. Till Rachel wanted to do Dudoim. Then it just came out of her. Like, I married 7 years watching Yaakov like you better. So Rachel at this point, a regular woman, any regular man or woman would say, I'll tell you the truth. I want you to know. Really, it was my simonim. I since I see you hurt, I want to tell you what really happened. Not Rachel. She wouldn't hurt her kiyuze. Instead, she said, Ochem, you know what? I see you're hurting. I will speak to Yaakov to spend more time with you if you give me some of those herbs. I'll speak to him. And sure enough, Yaakov did it. And what do we find in the next psukim in this week's parasha coming up? She had Yisachar and Zvulun. Now she has 6 children. 6 sons. 6 sons thanks to Rachel's generosity. But then, Leah's generous. Leah's carrying son number 7, Yosef. And she knows that she's in a veil. She asks Hashem, please don't give me this son. Please don't give me this son, my poor sister. I'm going to have, at least she should have as much as the Shvachos. Bilhah has two, Zilpah has two. I can't leave her with one. Give this baby to my sister, to Rachel. So Baruch Hashem, Vatahar Rachel, Hashem gave Yosef to Rachel. It's a strength. Rachel gave away Shvatim. She gave away her dream of marrying Yaakov. There's a certain, how could she do it? How could she do it? And Leah gave away a shevet. She was carrying a shevet. And she thought more about her sister than herself. All this takes tremendous koyach. And what did she get for it? The big question is what she got for it. So Hashem gave, she was carrying a child. Hashem gave her Dina at that time. So you would think that she gave away Yosef and got Dina. You'd think that this Dina is going to be the biggest rebbetzin of the biggest seminary in Eretz Yisrael. How did she get this Dina? By giving away Yosef. What happens in the next parasha of Yishlach? Shem captures Dina. He's Mezana. There's a baby born. The baby ends up in Mitzrayim. And Leah doesn't ask a single question on Hashem. And Yosef doesn't when he sits in jail after saying no to Potiphar's wife. As we go through the parashia, strength and strength and strength. And Yosef does have, he does say where he got the strength from. The Medrash says, when he says to his brothers about his dreams, we're making bundles. So the Medrash asks, that's a funny lashon for bundles, halumim. The bundle usually is oimer in the Torah for a bundle. But the Medrash says he was trying to hint to them, how will I become in the future? What strength will I have to serve Hashem with tremendous tests and survive the tests and pass the tests? Il Musa de'ima, the silence of an Elam is someone who can't speak. My mother's silence, the fact that she didn't answer back her sister, she had such tremendous strength. And she didn't say that she was the one who Yaakov was supposed to marry, that the lover was tricking her. She held back. She was at such tremendous strength. I inherited that strength from my mother. And he was able to say no to Potiphar's wife, a 17-year-old teenager alone. So where did all this come from, all this tremendous strength? And so we see again in this upcoming week's parasha, Vayikach my Avnei Hamakim, this covers both inyanim. The inyanim of our giving more cover to our tefillah and to our Torah and the Achdus. When Yaakov was about to go to sleep by Har HaMeriah. So it says, my Avnei Hamakim, he took many stones. We read it today by Mincha. We read these psukim by Mincha this afternoon. He put 12 stones around his head representing the future Shvatim that he knew as a Navi he would have. But when he woke up in the morning, he took the one stone. He woke up and saw all 12 stones melted into one. So the Medrash says that Hashem wanted to make a siman. Each one of these 12 Shvatim had their own flag, their own personality, their own shlichus in life. But you could have achdus even though you're different than each other. That Yaakov was assured by HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The fact that he's having 12 different shvatim with 12 different purposes and brachas from Yaakov Avinu himself, later on in Vayechi, but they can all respect each other and work together and love each other, it can work. It can work. How can it work? It can work if a person deals with things with emes. With Emes, and we find in next week's parashah in Vayishlach that he fought the Yetzahar, he fought the Malach of Esav. Vayivaser Yaakov Levadui. He remained alone. He went back for Pachim Katanim. He went back for the small jugs that he had forgotten. Now Yaakov was a multimillionaire at this point. When he left Lavan's house, he went there a pauper. But he left, it says in the Medrash, unbelievable, he said, I think it says he had 600,000 sheep dogs to guard his sheep. You can imagine how many sheep he had. He was a multimillionaire. Why did he go back for Pachim Katanim? Because he felt, if the Eibishter gave it to me, it has a chashivas to me. I can't just let things go. Hashem gave me something. I have to take care of it. It's something from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He went back for it. And he fought the Malach of Esav, and the Malach couldn't win. But the Malach at least dislocated his pelvis. It says the Karlsbad der Rav in his Sefer about Hanukkah, that the pelvis holds up the torso. It's the support system that holds up the upper body. We balance ourselves, Baruch Hashem, on our pelvis. That's what we balance ourselves on. And it was a hint to him that even though he can't stop Yaakov from learning Torah, but if he could dilute the Torah and make it polluted by the support system, by ruining the support system, people should support the Torah dishonestly, because everything has an effect, as we said. The Ruchnius comes through. Like by Noach, it says that Noach never suffered so much. He didn't have children until he was 500 years old. So the Rashi asks on the spot in the end of Parshas Bereishis. Everybody else had children by 130, 140, 120, 500? How much suffering they went through. Hundreds of years waiting to have children. So Rashi, but the Eibershter didn't want Noach's children to be 100 years old when the Mabul came. Because before the Torah was given, Misa Bidei Shamayim, dying, death from heaven, wasn't until the age of 100, before the Torah was given. After the Torah, it's age 20. But before there's age, so none of his children should be 100. They shouldn't have to die. They should be able to go with him in the teva and be saved in the Mabul. Noach shouldn't have the Agmas Nefesh of losing his children. So the Hachaim HaKadosh asks, I heard this, I didn't see it inside, from Yisrael Belsky about 30 years ago. I heard him tell this over. The Hachaim HaKadosh, weren't there a million children under 100 when the Mabul happened? Only Noach's three children were under 100? What about the rest of the world that had children until then? So he answers, but they all ate. Kimolah ha'aretz chomos b'pneihem. Their Cheerios from stolen money. Their bread from stolen money. Their chicken from stolen money. So there was no hope for them. Because the ruchnius of that stealing of the food, it came into them. Dishonest things. It goes through the system. There was no hope. But Noach was the only honest person in the world. So therefore, his children, there was hope for. There was hope for them. So he dislocated the pelvis of Yaakov to indicate that the support system he's going to get a hold of, he'll hurt that support system for the Torah, so the Torah shouldn't be 100% pure. So we see the Nakuda of Emes. That's how important it is. From what the Satan tried to do to Yaakov when he saw he couldn't take the Torah mamish away from him, he figured at least he'll take away the purity of the Torah. That's why we look for Shemen Zayizoch, pure olive oil, to light the Lachanak Lech with the opposite, to remind ourselves of what the Esav tried to do at that time. So it answers, that was the foundation of all of our Ovis and Yimohis and Yosef HaTzadik. They left because Hashem said to leave, because they went with an emes. If Hashem says so, then it's got to be right, then I have to leave. It's hard. It might be hard, but HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants it. And Avram could do the Akedah against all of his intellect. It didn't make sense to him. But Hashem did say so. And honestly, I know HaKadosh Baruch Hu runs this world. And if he says so, I have to keep on going. And I have to continue, no matter what. And you see how these almanais of these Kedoshim from last week, what's on their mind? Klal Yisrael. That means that with all this enormous test that they had, that their husbands in the middle of davening, heilige people, and with their hatalas and tefillin on, are brutally killed. And what's on their mind? What can Klal Yisrael do to get closer to Hashem? So these things shouldn't happen again. Not that they have an anger, I can't daven, I can't learn anymore, I can't get stuck, I'm so angry, how could this happen? Where's HaKadosh Baruch Hu? No. They write a letter and they all four sign it during the Shiva. To me, it's like mind-boggling. But it goes through in our genes from Avram and Sarah, from Yitzchak and Rivka, so Rivka could have the strength not to cause her husband's learning to be disturbed by knowing what he doesn't have to know until he has to know it. When he has to know it, so he was an awakening to him. He said to Yosef, I can't give you brachais anymore. But also, he goes, one of the reasons was he felt Gehenim coming. He felt it. But this Nakuda of Emes is the Nakuda. And I just want to close, and then we have to work on it. The Lashon that I wrote down from Rav Kirzner, one of his shmuzen, he says, Emes is using everything as a bridge to Hashem. And the Nesiva Shalom says it in the parsha we learned this morning. V'yitin l'cha elokim mital ha-shamayim. Says, he brings a medrash. V'yitin l'cha elokuso mital ha-shamayim. He gave a bracha to Esav. He thought it was Esav. Really, it was Yaakov of Gashmias. You should have a lot of assets. You should be able to help your brother with these assets. But elokuso, whatever you get from Hashem, before you spend it, think, is HaKadosh Baruch Hu happy with this way I'm spending it? Am I supposed to go on this vacation? Will HaKadosh Baruch Hu like this place I'm going to? Will he like this outfit that I'm buying? Is something HaKadosh Baruch Hu will like? He'll feel this is the right kind of outfit that I should wear. Everything the book I'm buying, the disc I'm buying, the music disc, Will HaKadosh Baruch Hu be happy with this? He should give you godliness with the brachos of Gashmias, to think about Hashem. M.S. said Rav Kurzner, this is a quote, is using everything as a bridge to Hashem, saying yes and saying no, knowing when, unifying, joining the beginning, the middle, and the end of life with HaKadosh Baruch Hu to make our whole life one. One, traveling with the Rebbeinu Shlom, holding the Eibishter's hand. That's the koyach of Emes. So that's when the Pshatim, the Karlsbad, the Rav says, Umi noisar kan kanim, nase neis lashoishanim. Because Yaakov left over his kankanim. He went back to get these little jugs that he forgot. From that battle against Esav, he taught us about how pure things have to be. So when we found that the Yevonim were metame all the oil, did you ever wonder why they were metame the oil? Why didn't they break every jug and let the oil spill all over the floor and we have no oil? They have to bother undoing the seal, putting in a dead sheretz, and being metame the oil? Just spill it out. No, they didn't want to spill it out. They want us to light the menorah with oil that's tamei, so we get some bad vibrations of tumah into our system. A light that's a tumadika light. You know, we'll get some tumah into our system. That was more important to them than making us lose the oil. So that's again, we didn't use the oil. Really, tumas hutra b'tzibur. The Gemara speaks about it in Shabbos. We could have used that oil that was tamei. If we had no other oil, it's mutar. Hutra b'tzibur. But we wouldn't do it. We knew the lesson. We noisar kankanim. From the kankan that Yaakov left over across the river by Mari Yaboik. So later on, the Shoshanim, Shoshanas Yaakov, the roses, Klal Yisrael, they found one jug. Hashem made a miracle that we found one with a seal on it. And it lasted for 8 days. A miracle happened because the Eibishter saw we were moisen nefesh for purity, for MS. So from those kankanim that Yaakov left over, we ended up with an Eis LaShoshanim. So at this tremendously testing time for Klal Yisrael, we have to try to be honest with ourselves and in everything that we do, MS. Like, you know, if I have to miss a Shacharis, we have to think, what did I sell the Shacharis for? Why did I miss it? Was it really a worthwhile thing that I stayed up for last night, that I missed my Shacharis? You have to be honest. Or I missed a seder of learning to buy a suit for $100 less because they made a sale. You buy one suit, you get three for free. But I sold my seder for $100 or for $500. Is it worth selling my seder? We have to be honest with ourselves. I sold my shalom bayis. I made a joke at my wife's expense, at my husband's expense, because I wanted to get a laugh from all my friends. And then I'll apologize to my wife later, to my husband later. What did I sell it for? To get a laugh from somebody? That's all part of being honest with ourselves and thinking about HaKadosh Baruch Hu. What does the Eibishter want? Why did I argue with my family? With the Shalom, with the Achdus counts first. When these women write a letter to us, all these Almonos, they mean start at home with the Achdus. And then it should spread to Klal Yisrael 100%. But what did I argue about? Was it important enough? The precious years that we're zoicha, that our children need us. What do I give it up for? Do I give it up to be imprisoned in my cell phone, in the prison cell of a phone, and therefore I don't have the time or the mind for my children when they need me? I'm busy telling them half the time, I'm on the phone. Don't you see I'm on the phone? Maybe I shouldn't be. What am I giving it up for? You know, we have to, or during a shacharis, or during a seder, because I'm addicted to text, or a makash and ksuf about Torah called Facebook that ruins the face of my ruchniyistic life. Do I have to have a part in that book? What do I give things up for? We should be, Bezer Hashem Yisbarach, honest with ourselves, live with an emes, and we'll be able to ask HaKadosh Baruch Hu the final stanza that we sing in Mo'ez Sur Yeshua, so we beg Hashem Yisbarach, Hasoiv Zeroya Kotshecha. We had such karbonis. Really, these four were shocking. But really, we should have been shocked on Erev Tisha B'Av already. By that, the original, the beginning of this new infatara, when this Russian Marushim Achshav Zechariah Arab took over a crane and turned over a bus, and Rahman Aslan killed a 29-year-old father of six, you know, and leaving a young wife in her 20s with six Yesoimen. You know, his oldest was 9 years old. You know, we have to be shaken up by all of that and beg HaKadosh Baruch Hu, we get the message. Our tefillah will be better. our learning will be better, our shalom will be better at home and globally. We'll daven for all Yidden. We will love all Yidden. Chasoiv zeroya kodshecha. Reveal your holy arm. V'korev keitz ha-Yeshua. And bring the end. Bring the Yeshua to us. Nekoyim nikmas dama v'adechem ayum ha-harashol. Take revenge of the blood of your servants from that evil nation. And the Arizal writes, before Mashiach comes, Edom will give the reins of the Golos to Yishmael. He writes it 400 years ago. The Golos will end with Yishmael. Bal HaTurim writes it, look it up, in the end of last week's parsha. Al Kol Pnei Echov Nofol, says the Bal HaTurim. The last words of last week's parsha are, Yishmael falls on his face in front of his brothers. The next pasuk is, Eila Tolus Yitzchak Ben Avraham. When you'll see Yishmael fall, you'll know Mashiach is coming, says the Bal HaTurim. So take revenge from that evil nation that took over the Golos. Ki Orchalanu HaYeshua, it's such a long time, we're here almost 2,000 years. Ve'en Keitz LiMehara, we don't see the end to the days of negative things. So, Dechei Admoin B'Tzeel Tzalmoin. Push away the red one, which today is Yishmael. In the dark shadow that they cause, that push them into the darkness, into Gehenna. Hakeim lanu royeshiva, Beis Hashem Yisbarach. You'll bring back that time that we'll have our seven shepherds back in Mitzvah Hashem, and there's a chus that we came here to be mechuzak, and the Eibush to seize that we're going to be better. Mitzvah Hashem, you should bring us to Yeshua, but Korah, we should celebrate Chanukah hopefully. Or Chadosh al Tzion Toir, there'll be a new light on Yerushalayim. V'niska chulanu. And all of Klal Yisrael, not just us, all of Klal Yisrael all over the world, and the 80% who don't know Hashem yet will also be Zaychem. And this is Hulanu, v'mheira la'ayre. Thank you very much.
Shkach Rabbi Finkelman, just one more moment, please, ladies and gentlemen. I know that the Rebbe's in a rush to Bar Mitzvah, so I'll make the announcements very quickly. We also want to thank the three organizations that were involved with tonight's gathering. Of course, Chickens for Shabbos, Rabbi Newman. You could donate to Chickens for Shabbos by taking an envelope on your desk over there or online at chickensforshabbos.com. Of course, the Queen Jewish Community Council, QJCC, Warren and Cynthia. They're going to be having a bike ride, a marathon on Thursday to all of the 130 locations that they have Meals on Wheels. You could donate online for that on qjcc.org. Of course, Chazaq. Announcement regarding that. We're going to be having Rav Shalom Arish, the author of The Garden of Emunah, along with Rabbi Lazer Brody, this Tuesday, live at the Youngers of Kew Garden Hills. All are welcome. There is a small admission charge of $15. You'll see flyers outside. We want to also thank the Shul, Rabbi Walcher, the Gabbai, Mark Frankel, and Mr. Hochster, and my good friend Alicia for helping organize with tonight's event. Yaakov, for all your PR and promotions, thank you very much. And every month we collect for a different institution, different organization. This month we're going to be collecting for Hatzalah, being that it's Shabbos Hatzalah. So there is no baskets. Everyone wants to leave any donations, you can leave it on the Bima. We'll make sure it goes to the right place. Thank you very much, everyone. Good Vach, Shavua Tov.